Good morning, friends. Chanel here. I'm with Deborah Salazar Shapiro, author of the children's book, A Magical Mindful Day.
Hey, welcome.
Hi, everyone.
I'm really excited to have her here today. She's an incredibly inspiring person, and I hope that you guys all enjoy hearing her story. So, you are a psychotherapist with a master's of social work?
I started as a licensed psychologist in El Salvador, so I'm from El Salvador.
Okay.
So my career started there. I decided to do this master's in social work. There's a lot of service, and we see the person as a whole with a lot of needs, and we help them find resources, psychotherapy. It's a very broad way of seeing the person and the things that they need.
Here in San Diego, you work with veterans and military?
I used to work with them.
Did they have more specific needs than other people because of potentially like post-traumatic stress?
It's a different way of being and living. So one of the things that is for us inspiring to help them readjust when they move back into society, when
sure.
they're not on tour anymore and they just want to reintegrate themselves into society. So it's a different way of living and lifestyle.
Did you find that working with those kind of people kind of broadened your understanding of needs as a human being?
Definitely. Growing up in El Salvador in a time of war, I was exposed to seeing military. I even have friends with parents in the military, and I used to see how different was their lifestyle. And USC, that's where I did my master's in social work. They had the specialization in military social work and veterans. So I thought, why not to serve those who serve us as well? So that's why I did the training, and I work with them at the VA during my training.
How long have you been in the field of psychology?
So psychology and social work, let's say, just trying to help others, more than 15 years.
Wow.
And working with children and families.
Outside of just being a social worker, you do so much more. And mm-hmm. with that, I mean, you have endless background in education. Can you talk about where you've studied?
I study in El Salvador, a license in psychology. So in El Salvador, I'm considered a psychologist. So when you move to a different country, kind of you leave your degrees behind.
Sure.
So when I came here, I decided to pursue a master's in social work. While I was doing my master's degree, mindfulness was something that caught my attention. Trying to help others find ways of reduce suffering. My training, not only in social work, but definitely training in psychology, trying to find different techniques, how to help others. It's how I ended up in mindfulness. So with mindfulness, I study at UCLA. It's called a mindful facilitator degree for a total of 2 years. Also, I've been studying with, now it's called the Compassion Institute. It's a course, 8-week course designed to teach others about kindness and compassion. So, but it was developed by the scholars and also other psychotherapists, psychologists at Stanford University.
Amazing.
So these are trainings that you take in order to teach mindfulness.
Mm-hmm.
And they are research-based at UCSD, Mindfulness-Based Stress Reduction. So this last one was created more than 30 years ago.
Wow. You took everything that you've learned and you've written this book, Ooh. A Magical Mindful
yeah.
Day. Before we talk about your book, I wanted to kind of take a step back and talk about your time growing up as a child in El Salvador. Like you had said, you'd faced war, you had faced poverty. There's a lot of challenges in your upbringing, and I kind of wanted you to touch on that before we talked about your book. So would you share with us your story?
Yes, definitely. I think I was very fortunate to grow up in El Salvador and experience the things that I experienced and saw. I was about 4 when the war started, the Civil War, and my parents had to move to a different country. They decided it was a choice to move. So why? Because there was threats, or it just simply the wars had started. And my father was a cinematographer and photographer.
Amazing.
So there was a lot of things going on that I don't even understand at this time, right?
Right.
We moved. I was an immigrant at very young age. So we moved to Mexico at a state called Chiapas. My parents separated, and 3 years later, I moved back to El Salvador.
Had the culture changed at all, or was it still in a state of war and poverty?
It was still. So we reached peace until many, many years later.
Okay.
When you grew up in a country where you see a lot of needs and poverty, even natural disasters, we're very known for have a lot of earthquakes and even hurricanes, and it's you're seeing it needs. It's a country with amazing people, but there's a lot of need. So when I was 8 years old, I decided that I wanted to be a psychotherapist.
Amazing.
And to help. So why? Because somebody touched my life. And it was a school psychologist. She called me to the office. Probably she saw me that I was sad because my parents were separated.
Sure.
And I think her compassion inspired me to say, I want to do this. Instead of going into a different path, because even at a young age, you see that there are other little kids. I always seen that they were not adapting or already doing drugs and different things like that. And I thought, maybe I want to go in a different way and just help. I have been very, very focused since I was very young to try to plant seeds of compassion, kindness to help others.
You were able to use your childhood life experience and the influence that you had from the nurturers around you in El Salvador to help you write this beautiful book for children. Can you kind of touch on how you were inspired to create this book?
I have two daughters, and when my oldest daughter, who is 17 already, when she was around probably 8 years old in middle school, I was a PTA chair of a green team, and I used to help organize things with the team, recycling events and things like that for children. At the same time, I had started learning about mindfulness, and I realized, is there a connection between caring about the environment, or is there a way to connect to make children learn? And then I thought, maybe because we're not understanding where we are connected. I sat down one day and I wrote a story, but I thought I wasn't ready. I had a lot of doubt, and I thought, I can't do this right now. Mm-hmm. So I put it away. And then many years forward, my second one was born. And one day I was nursing her, and I was looking at the books on her bookshelf, and I thought, how can I teach her about this topic? There are children's books about mindfulness, beautiful book, but there's not anything about teaching about interconnectedness and about the environment, mindfulness in the environment. And then I thought, okay, I think I'm ready to do this. In between, there were a lot of years, and one of the things that helped me a lot, besides growing up in El Salvador, Green, very connected with the ocean,
sure,
with the earth, was traveling and seeing around the world, countries, places, people that care and other people that didn't care. I was in a ferry one day going to Zanzibar, an island of Tanzania. I can picture very vividly how people were throwing plastic bottles into the ocean.
Directly into the ocean?
Directly into the ocean. And I was like, oh, wow. No. What can I do? But still, it wasn't the time. I think it had another little being had to come and say, you and other little ones inspire me. How can we help you? Or just plant the seed of conserve or care about our environment. Only understanding how we are all interconnected, how we're all one, right? Animals, other little beings. And of course, about each other, about how we are connected when we are good with our environment, with others.
With your studying mindfulness, did you also do yoga training or meditation training or all of the other elements that link with it?
So definitely I practice yoga. I'm a yoga enthusiast. Mm-hmm. I just need to carve time to go and do it. It definitely helps your body, right? Connecting body and mind. When I was about 14, 15 years old, this is in Salvador, my mother was very curious about learning as well. And I used to go to different classes and different types of meditation. So mindfulness is it's a form of meditation. And so far has been my favorite and the one that I like to teach. A definition that I really like that I've heard from a teacher at UMass is where MBSR, mindfulness-based stress reduction, was developed. It's moment-to-moment awareness without judgment. It's simple,
you
right?
You can feel it as you say it.
It's so simple. I love it. I said, I'm going to borrow it. And I don't know who created it, but I thank her or him. Most of my training has been in mindfulness meditation. For example, my first training or retreat was a 10-day silent retreat.
Wow.
With Chuck Kornfield, who's a very well-known teacher, and now his wife, Trudy Goodman. And I was pregnant at the time.
Aww.
And it was beautiful. And I had also the opportunity to go, I'm a busy mom and working, but to go to Burma or Myanmar now.
Yeah, Myanmar.
Where a lot of my teachers who are at UCLA or other schools went, and I was curious, where did you get your training? I want to see where, but maybe not necessarily the origin, but it has been transmitted over thousands and thousands of years. They teach it the same way, so a little different. So here and there, love learning. So, but mostly it's about mindfulness and having a very a daily practice is very important for me.
And you also studied Buddhism around the world as well.
Well,
it's
all connected. So mindfulness is a
little element in the teachings.
Correct. Yeah. It's backed up by science, which is I love.
Yeah.
And we can go anywhere and it's open. You can be a Catholic,
sure.
any religion, and just learn about mindfulness meditation. Take that little teaching that is, yes, it started in Buddhism, but now science has given us the gift of why does it work.
With all of the mindfulness education that you have in your background, you now teach mindfulness yourself. So you teach seminars, private classes?
Yes. All of that.
Yeah.
Seminar, private classes, I offer consultations, one-on-one to groups, and especially the 8-week courses that are very beneficial to organizations, like such a hospital, an organization that has a very fast-paced type of work.
Does it help with team building? You know how they send their company's employees out on retreats to do like team building exercises? Is it a way for them to be more mindful about their own place in the workplace or how they work with each other or all of it?
It could be everything.
Sure.
Right? When you practice mindfulness, you learn to be more present, be more fully alive and connected. So it's all related.
Are you teaching it almost subconsciously to your children? Do you see it reflecting in your daughters and their behavior and the way that they treat other people?
I think so. I think it's very important as a parent to model.
Yeah.
That's the best thing I've been asked. How did I teach my child? So 3.5-year-old Ariana, when I'm sitting, I usually do my longer meditations between daily, which is between 30 and 45 minutes. If it's a day to treat an hour a day. And I used to want to do it alone, in silence, very early in the morning. I'm an early morning person.
Yes.
So 4:35 on a good day. So that's when I sleep, when I slept well.
Yeah.
If not, even if it's 5 minutes, 3 breaths, but on those times, probably she's already awake and
right.
I'm running late and didn't get up on time or something. And she's there. She sits next to me and she takes the same 3 breaths. Or I said, oh, Ariana, come and take breaths. And it's a way of being modeling, being kind, try to be compassionate. We have to embody, especially if you want to share mindfulness with others as a teacher, we definitely practice so we can embody this presence, right? It's an aspiration. It's an aspiration to be like that.
I feel like as a daughter myself, I always struggled with being told what to do, whether it was by my father or my grandparents. I always kind of, you know, would judge other people for telling me what to do,
yes.
And then they didn't, you know, behave the way that they had asked me to behave. And I think that's what potentially made me such an angst-ridden youth. But I couldn't commend you more for actually embodying those behaviors that you wish to see in the people, not just your daughter, but the people around you. Because as you said, that's probably the most effective way at creating that movement, like the movement of thoughtful behavior. You exude this beautiful, peaceful nature that is so infectious that I'm calm sitting next to you, and I feel like I feel like now I'm just gonna meditate the whole day out.
I'm not peaceful all the time.
Well, it's almost impossible to just be zenned out in a meditation pose for your entire life.
And guess what? One of the reasons why I started learning about mindfulness is because I had a difficulty regulating my own emotions. I had a lot of anger. So that's why. And you're right, embodying, going back to embodying my teenage daughter. She was older when I tried to kind of, you want to learn this? And of course, she was a little, not really, maybe some. I think mindfulness is not for everyone. But when you model, maybe you plant a seed here and there, and now she's already on her way to college. I can see bits and pieces of something maybe she saw, she's experienced.
Yeah.
And that's what makes me happy. That's all it's about.
She might come back to you in 10 years where she's starting to develop her own family, and she'll come back and say, Mom, I want to sit down and learn how to put myself in check. The fact that she has such a great resource at hand to be able to pick your brain about these little details that might make her life easier.
Yes, and if it isn't, I know we all try to find our way in the world, right? What resonates with us.
Exactly.
That's another thing I love about mindfulness. When you sit and you're with your body and you let everything settle, you learn to trust yourself. And is this what I need? No, it isn't. And you learn to trust your gut and just trust where you need to go or where you want to go. We live in a fast-paced world, right? There's no news. So that's why I personally think there's a lot of ways you can practice before you go to bed, maybe during midday. But because I'm an early morning person, it just helps me to sit and breathe and even set an intention of that's very important of my practice and in life. Set an intention. What is our intention today? Do I want to be kind? What is then the general intention of being in the world as a human being? And of course, we might not be the most mindful and compassionate person throughout the day, but at night to say, how did I do today?
Yeah.
Without judgment.
Yeah.
Just being kind with herself and say, I did the best I could today.
I love that idea, because if you're able to self-evaluate in the evening and kind of clear the energy that you created during the day, it kind of sets you for that rebirth in the morning.
Correct.
So that when you wake up and you're aware of how yesterday went, you can now tweak with those intentions how you behave today.
And something very important is to be compassionate with yourself, knowing that yesterday was yesterday and you did the best you could.
I know that there are so many people in our audience that constantly are asking me for these kinds of tips. Like, these are morning people that want to live beautiful days out, that have this kind of inspiration. So if there are people in our audience that want to take any of these classes or get tips from you, do you have information on your website on how to? Okay. So we will provide that information for you guys if you want to contact Deborah and utilize her amazing services and get all kinds of beautiful, wonderful tips on how you can start your day with mindfulness. Where do you go from here? I feel like right now you are touring with interviews on your book, promoting this beautiful piece of artwork. Did you create the art in this book as well?
Yes. I'm a co-illustrator with Addison Stone Street, which is a local San Diego artist as well.
Amazing.
So a shout out to Addison.
Is it watercolor? Did you guys paint?
It's watercolor, yes.
So amazing. I'm very excited to have my own copy. If you guys want to purchase your own for your little ones or even for yourself, I'll also have a link for that as well for you to buy. Do you have any future plans for more education or more traveling or more worldly impact?
I want to go and deepen my yoga practice and go to India soon, hopefully next year.
Do you have connections, or are you in like the research stage of that?
I think how the universe works, you just meet people. So I've been meeting a lot of people from India that live here. Some of them are yoga teachers. We even planning maybe going together, or just say we know where we can send you, and even resources there. I'm trying to figure it out.
I appreciate you so much. I am so glad to share your beautiful piece of artwork with our audience. And I wish you all the best of luck and success in the future with more education and helping other people on their path for mindfulness.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. It takes a lot of generosity and kindness to be able to do this. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.